Hey everyone, every household nowadays seems to have a dozen different computers, ranging from phones to tablets and laptops to PCs. This can be great, but it also makes sharing files consistently between them all quite difficult. You might have all your photos on one device and all your sensitive financial documents on another, sometimes without having an easy or effective way of accessing those files from a different device. There are two main approaches to solve this problem, cloud and local. The cloud is so easy, man. Just chuck your files there and let the cloud gods sort it all out. You can chill here while your data chills up in the peaceful cloud kingdom. You've got to wake up and see the cloud for what it is. A virtual panopticon designed by soulless corporations to monitor and manipulate us. Don't be a cog in their machine. Keep your files offline and hidden. Which one of those beautiful people is right? Well, I can think of 9 different ways that you can keep track of your files across a range of devices. Some of these are cloud-based, some are local-only, and some use a mix of both. The first method I wanted to cover is a local-only method, and it's to install file syncing software like SyncThing or Resilio Sync. SyncThing is free and open source, while Resilio's is more of a paid solution. There is a free tier for personal use, but it's naturally restricted compared to the paid-for versions. Whichever software you use, though, both of these effectively push and pull files between a configured set of devices, meaning that I could ensure that all of my phone's photos are always available on my desktop PC as well. Yes, I can naturally achieve this by using Google Photos or iCloud, but the point of SyncThing and Resilio is that you keep your files on your own computers and servers at all times. You don't need to rely on some third-party cloud servers from Google or Apple. That's the key point here. Back in the day, many Linux users would use a tool like rsync to ensure that files are propagated to all required devices, and that still works well. But these two tools are more user-friendly and often easier to manage for the average user. So they could be a good option to explore if you like the idea of having cloud-like file sharing without a cloud. The main downside of this option is that you need to install extra software on all of your devices, your phone, your computer, your laptops, everything, compared to things like iCloud that already exists on all your Apple devices, for example. That brings me on to the second method, which is to use cloud-based methods. This might mean OneDrive on Windows systems, Google Photos and Drive on Android phones and Chromebooks, or iCloud on those overpriced white devices. Sorry, I meant to say Apple products. These programs will usually already exist on many of your devices, meaning that if you want to share photos between an Android phone and a Chromebook, for example, you just need to launch Google Photos on both, and hey presto, it's there on both. Simple. Because the photos are backed up to Google's cloud servers, you can pretty much access them anywhere. Or if you build a spreadsheet with Apple numbers, you can then store it on iCloud and access it from any of your other Apple devices really easily too. The good thing with this approach is this often ultra simple and seamless. Plus, you can still access Google and Apple cloud files from a Windows device, for example. Or if you mainly use the Windows cloud software, OneDrive, you can then access Microsoft OneDrive cloud files on Android and Apple products simply by installing the OneDrive app. This is all great, but the downside of relying on cloud storage is that you're putting all your sensitive files and photos onto other companies' servers, and then you're placing your entire trust in them. These cloud services often have a single point of failure, such as your iCloud login, which can potentially be targeted in phishing scams, allowing hackers to then access all of your files. Equally, cloud servers can shut down, just like Amazon shut down Amazon Drive last month. If you relied on Amazon Drive for all of your file storage and syncing needs, you'd now be out of luck. The other downside of cloud storage is that it's not really free. iCloud and OneDrive only offer you a paltry 5 gigs of storage for free, which isn't much, especially in the era of high-res photos. Google gives 15 gigs, which is a bit better, but to be honest, all cloud services want you to pay them for extra storage. That's their business model. I use, and so I pay, for close to 100 gigs of Google Drive storage, for example. And this is the main problem of cloud storage. It can get quite expensive, costing £80 per year for 2 terabytes of storage. This brings me on to the third file sharing approach you could try out, and that's this stands for network attached storage. And it can be a local-only way of sharing files, or it can be a mix of cloud and local. It's up to you. Basically, you can buy a mini computer and insert some hard drives into this, and then attach that to your home network, either by plugging it in to your router or a network switch. Then the various devices around your house can access the files on this device, on the NAS, either by connecting to the NAS as though it's any other Windows folder, or by downloading an app on your phone or tablet. The beauty of the NAS approach is that it allows you to get 4 terabytes of storage, for example, for less than the price of 1 year's of Google Drive's storage, sort of. A NAS can cost anywhere from £80 to, well, thousands. If all you want is a simple one-bay NAS, meaning you can fit one drive into it, you could pay £80 for the NAS and then buy a 4 terabyte drive for another £80, so you've then spent £160 in total. This will give you some really awesome storage capabilities, both on your local network and over the internet, so you can access your files if you're traveling. However, the problem here is that if a single drive fails, you then lose everything, all your files. The solution to this is to pay for backup storage space, although this can get expensive. Synology's own backup service costs €335 per year to protect all your files for the more expensive plan. That's not cheap, although there are some cheap alternatives out there at least. Another option is to buy a 2-bay NAS and then install a second hard drive and run it in RAID mode. This basically copies the data to both of your drives, which means that if one drive fails, your files are still protected because they're on the other drive. You can then buy a new drive, install that into your NAS, and the RAID array will be rebuilt, which is a fancy way of saying the files just get copied back from the single healthy drive to your newly purchased drive. Here's the thing though, RAID is not a backup. If your house burns down or your NAS is stolen, then you'd still lose all your files. So while a NAS is an awesome investment if you have lots of files to store and access, it probably won't work out cheaper than cloud storage, once you factor in all of the backup costs. What I personally do is pay for a small amount of backup space and ensure that my most crucial files are backed up there. And then I rely on RAID for everything else. Yes, RAID is not a backup, I know, but I'm happy with this approach and it works out cheaper than cloud storage overall. Even though I also pay for 100 gigs of Google Drive storage. I just like storage, I guess. You can configure the NAS to run only over your local network by turning off all the cloud access features. And this then means you have an entirely offline, local-only file sharing system. Well, hey. But if you want to access your files when you're traveling or you want cloud-based storage solutions, you're then heading into virtual panopticon territory. Just kidding, sort of. I personally trust Synology more than many of the big tech companies, so I'm personally happy to enable Synology cloud access and also use their backup solution, but your mileage may vary. The fourth way that you can share files between your different devices is a cloud-based approach that I like to call the chaos approach. This is where you and your partner, friends, colleagues, whoever, use a combination of email, Messenger, and WhatsApp to share random files with each other, without any consistency, systems, or rules. It is a quick and easy way of sharing files, of course, because everyone in an email or chat group can then access those files. But there's a downside. It's pure chaos. What happens is the colleague will email you a spreadsheet and they ask you to check it. You then change something and you email it back. A month later, your boss asks for a copy of the spreadsheet and someone accidentally sends them the original spready. Yes, I said spready. I worked in an office for a decade and words like spready now exists in my vocabulary. Sorry. Anyway, your boss now gets confused because your work isn't reflected in this spready or file. Or your partner sends you a cute picture they took of your kids, dog, pet goat, whatever. But instead of sending it via a cloud link, they sent it directly on Messenger or WhatsApp. Your partner then loses this file after changing phones. A year later, they ask to see that cute picture again. You definitely have it. I sent on Messenger a year ago, just before Christmas. Wait, no, it was just after Easter. But check on WhatsApp. I think I sent it there, actually. And you can't find it. You then get into trouble. And it's somehow my fault that I can't find this random file amongst a sea of random messages. I'm guessing all this, of course. This has totally never happened to me. But hopefully it shows why it's not ideal to share files over email, Messenger, WhatsApp, whatever, because it can quickly get out of control. The fifth approach is a local solution that works especially well in office environments, and is to use shared Windows folders or file sharing if you use Mac. Focusing on Windows though, by default all the files on your computer are limited to just your computer. No one else can see them. So your downloads, pictures, anything under documents, they're all private to your PC. Unless you're in work, in which case the IT department will probably be able to access them all, of course. But what happens if you need to share a bunch of files or pictures with someone else? Well, one option is to right-click a folder, go to Properties, and then Sharing. You can then choose one or more users that should also be able to access this folder. When you're done, Windows will give you a file path at the bottom that you can then send on to other users in the network, such as the same office. Then they can use this to see the files in that folder. You can also set things up so that other people can put new files into the folder or change what's already there. It's up to you. This approach can work very well in an office, like I mentioned, where everyone is using Windows. But it doesn't work too well in a typical household because the Windows file share can't always be opened on a Mac or, you know, an Android phone or Chromebook or something like that. Another way that you can share files between multiple devices is to use remote desktop software. This isn't a local solution because it requires an over-the-internet connection, but it's not really cloud-based either. This method requires something like TeamViewer or the remote desktop software that's built into Windows. You can then use this to transport yourself from one computer to another. For example, when I used to work for other people, we would sometimes remote desktop into our work computer from home using TeamViewer. Essentially, I would open TeamViewer here, connect to my work computer's TeamViewer instance, and then I could drag and drop files between the two computers. In other words, I could pull files from my work computer onto my computer here. Or I could transfer a file from this PC to my work one. This can work really well if you're only really looking at syncing files between two computers, but it quickly gets confusing if multiple people with multiple devices are using multiple remote desktop sessions to share files. This then becomes a bad version of shared folders, essentially. File transfers are usually fairly reliable in software like TeamViewer, but it can be a bit buggier on Windows' own remote desktop software. If you're using the Windows one, then make sure that you click Show Options before starting a session, and then go to Local Resources at the top, and ensure that everything under Drives is ticked. This will then show the various drives under your This PC section on your computer, and it should work fairly smoothly after that. The seventh way of sharing files is entirely local, and it'd make my paranoid friend really happy. USBs and external hard drives. Basically, you can go old school and store all your files on detachable storage media, to use the technical term. Once you've loaded what you need onto one of these devices, you can unplug it and take it to another computer. Plug it in and you can then easily access all the files on there. Bliss. This method works really well still, but there are a couple of downsides. Firstly, it works well for people within the same household or office, but it's naturally not practical to ship USBs off to colleagues on the other side of the world every time you want to share a file with them. Secondly, many workplaces are now paranoid about USB storage, and they often block unexpected USBs. In other words, if you've been working late at home on a presentation and you put on a USB to take it into the office, you might not then be able to transfer it to your work PC because it might not load up the USB. Whoops. But in general, this is one of the cheapest and quickest ways of sharing files within a household. Having said that, the eighth approach I have for you is even cheaper than USBs, but definitely not as quick or easy. Git. Wait, no, I'm not calling you a Git. I mean that you could use a version control system called Git to manage access to all your files. Git is used by programmers and web developers to manage all the technical files that make up our software and websites. It's actually a pretty cool technology because it allows hundreds of people potentially to work on the same set of files without anyone clashing. I mean, people will clash, they'll share the same file and work on the same file at the same time, but there's a process to then resolve that. If you have a set of project files and you wanted multiple people to work on them all at the same time, then Git could work really well for you. Essentially, you would create a Git repository, either locally on your computer using Git for Windows or using a cloud-based solution like GitHub. Other people will then install a Git client onto their computer, and then they can start accessing the files in your Git repo. This can get a little bit technical, so I won't dive into it more on this video, but Git can work really well, especially in technical environments. Ninth but not least, and yes, I know I didn't use that phrase right, is to use FTP, This stands for File Transfer Protocol, and it's quite literally a computer standard designed for file sharing and syncing. Isn't this exactly what we wanted in the first place? Well, yes, but it's a bit like Git. It's a more technical approach. As a result, the average PC user probably won't want to start sharing files with their housemates or their colleagues via FTP. But if you did want to explore this option, you would need to create an FTP server on your Windows machine, either by using a third-party program or by enabling FTP service within Windows features, and then laboriously configuring your new FTP server via the Internet Information Services Manager. Once this is all set up, you then basically have a super powerful Windows share that allows other users to connect to it and download or add files. You could either configure your FTP server to be local only, so that only your colleagues can use it, or enable remote access, so this sort of becomes a cloud-based file sharing approach. To be honest though, the average user probably isn't going to need or want to set up an FTP server so that they can share funny pictures of their dogs with their partner. FTP is mainly used in technical environments. Phew, that's the 9 methods all laid out. I started with the common, user-friendly ones and then degenerated to really technical approaches that most people won't use. But in my opinion, they're still good to know about. As you can tell though, some of these methods work best in certain environments. For example, shared Windows folders will work really well in office environments where everyone else uses Windows. Or cloud storage like iCloud can work really well for non-technical people who just want an easy way to keep their files all synced up, and also have an easy way of sharing those files with other people. There's certainly nothing wrong with cloud-based approaches
designed by soulless corporations.
Pipe down, my paranoid amigo. It's fine to put all your files on the cloud as long as you understand that there could be some risks, especially if you use a weak iCloud password and have two-factor authentication disabled, for example, or if you stored everything on Amazon Drive and then it shut down. Also, if you do use a local-only method, like storing everything on USBs, then consider whether you need offsite backups. No one expects a disaster like the house burning down, but it could happen, and you could then lose all your files. Offsite backups doesn't have to be ultra expensive and technical though. It could be as simple as putting your most important files on a USB, and then keeping that USB at a trusted friend or family member's house. That wraps up today's video. I covered a lot of different methods, but I didn't want to dive into loads of detail on any specific method, because otherwise this video would have been 10 hours long or something. But if you did want more information on a particular method, please drop me a comment down below and I'll reply back and maybe create a more detailed tutorial in the future. I hope you found this video useful. If you did, please click the thumbs up button. While the YouTube algorithm is fairly smart, it does also kind of boil down to more likes equals more exposure. If you wanted to see more videos from me, then please also subscribe to me if you haven't already, and thanks for watching.